I did not put the name of the first guy. I'm sure you all know. So this is why I didn't put the name of this guy. But the second guy, Charles Townsend, had a swallow. They are the Nobel winner for the laser. And Gordon Gould is apparently the guy who is less known, but he claimed to have submitted the patent before Swallow and Charlestown. But he didn't get the Nobel Prize for that one, because their patent was accepted before him. Of course, after that, he went into court, and he got a lot of money because of that. So this was settlement outside court. And this Theodore Mammen is the guy who first constructed, actually, a ruby laser. And the laser, I'm sure you have heard this one. Laser is light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. It's very strange that laser basically is a process. But the name is now used for the machine which emits the radiation. The name is usually used for the radiation, actually. The radiation by itself will be called laser, so the laser beam. Laser is a machine, lasers are radiations, and laser is a process. So in fact, it is a process. Light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. I'm sure you have seen this one. This one is, I always say that this one is a wrong concoction. But for making people understand, it is very nice. That's why I'm sharing with you. Otherwise, I would say this is wrong. Quantum mechanical, this is wrong. This cannot be like this. So you have a photon coming in, and if it is hitting another atom, then the electrons will be excited, and then you have an excited state, and then after some time, you have the photons emitting out of the atoms. Feynman was once asked to give a talk to school teachers, primary school teachers, about science, how science is done. And he shared this story with the audience, that his father sent him to Cornell, to MIT, after getting a degree from Cornell and MIT, of course, very popular person. And his father said, there's one question which is bothering me. Now that you have come back from such high institutions, tell me, is there a photon residing inside an electron? That when an electron jumps from one state to another state, it gives out this electron. And of course, he couldn't answer. He said, sorry, Dad, I haven't really got to that point yet to understand that photon could be residing inside electron. And now that you are smiling, Feynman also said to the audience, those of you who are smiling, I'm sure you don't know whether the photon is residing inside an electron. But now, of course, science has progressed quite a lot. We know that photon is the quantized state of the waves. So the energy is there, so you get the energy out, it becomes a photon. So it will be. There is another thing, is why do we have spontaneous emission? What bothers the electron, when an electron, you bother it so much, you give energy to the electron, you disturb the electron to go to a higher state. Why suddenly the electron decide to jump back to the original state? So I'm sure this is something new, right? So how many of you understand this? Why would the electron bother to come back? No? Right. There is something called vacuum fluctuations. Have you heard this word, vacuum fluctuation? There's no complete vacuum. We have energy in the vacuum. And those energy, we have the ripples. And those ripples are making the electron to jump back. So electron will need a little bit. So that's why the lifetime of the spontaneous duration is quite short. So it goes to this state, but it stays very short time. Okay. The next one is when you have a photon coming in and it interacts with the electron, and then the electron is taken to an excited state, so the atom is in an excited state now. Then you have another electron coming in. So the electron is interacting with an excited state of an atom. Then that will give rise to two photons coming out. But now the two photons will be going in the same direction, and they will be in phase, and they will have the same. This is the beauty of the desert that if you consider just an ordinary light, sure the picture is not really good. This I try to have a bulb here. So you have different colors emitting in different direction. So if you have an LED, you have the same color, but it's, of course it's going in all directions. It's not in the same direction. But if you have a laser, just like a helium laser, then you have one color, almost one, of course, because otherwise you will have the violation of the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. So monochromatic means not really one color, not exactly one color, not delta function. But still the spectrum is quite narrow. The full width half maximum spectrum is in a few milliangstrom. So for many of us, laser is just a machine, a black box, where you have this thing written on it, danger, and this danger sign, do not touch it, things like that. So what we know usually is a black box, light coming in, is amplified, you have many photons coming out. Instead of two or three, you are having the same thing coming out. If you open it up, this is a very simple thing inside a laser. You have basically a combination of two mirrors. One is fully polished, 100% reflector. The other one is partially reflective mirror. In between, you have a medium which we call as a gain medium. This is a laser medium. And then you pump the laser medium through a source which we call as a pump source or a flash lamp. And then you produce a laser beam coming out. So either you do it through spontaneous or you can do it through stimulated emission. The one more thing regarding the laser, that usually we consider the laser has to be because of the electrons which are bonded to an atom. So you have an electron from the excited states, you make that electrons to come back to the ground state, and then you will have the radiations coming out, and this is how laser is. But this is not the only laser we have. For example, we have the free electron laser, where you do not need to have the electrons bound to a certain state, to a certain atom, or to a certain nucleus. These are free electrons. You simply change the direction of these electrons moving with the relativistic speed, or you change the speed of those electrons and you get the radiation, because remember, a charged particle, a moving charged particle, or especially when it's accelerating, it will radiate, and this is how we get the free electron laser. What is our motivation for the laser wake field acceleration? Of course, money matters, all because of, well, mostly because of money. Okay. If you think about this one, we have the cathode ray in the beginning. It was very small. People were very happy. They were doing experiment with it. They were quite contented with the work they were doing. But we always have some people who are not really happy with the way they are. They would like to improve upon what they are doing. So these are the people who came up and they have built another generator. These are the two guys, Wharton, Rutherford and Cockcroft. And they built another one, which is a bigger one. And there comes people who think, no, this is not enough. So they started using superconducting RFQBT. This was thanks to the superconductivity I mentioned. Then you have superconducting magnets. So they came up with this idea to have RFQBTs, put them together, and to make a machine 3 kilometer long. This is actually a machine, 3 kilometer long machine, which is giving us 50 giga electron volt and 3.3 kilometer. So it's a very high energy particle, basically. These are electrons. And they are thinking, there are people still not happy. They think they need a bigger machine. So in future, they're thinking of having a machine which will be 31 kilometer long to accelerate electrons. And these are basically for electron and positron, because the heavier particle would not be actually suitable for this. These are the guy. So I've done it in the wrong direction, but this was a picture appeared in one of the magazines where people were sitting on the water tank of the RFQBT. And the inventor of the QBT, they thought, oh God, when we were doing it, it was very small. So they published this picture. They were having the whole machine on their shoulders, but they were, at that time, they were very happy with this one. So this was 1947. And these are the guys, they said, okay, when we were doing it, it was so small. These are two brothers. They are the inventor of this electron. Okay. And now going to the other side of the circular one, 1930, people were talking about having an accelerator. This guy, Lorenz, was having, this is the circle that I'm having here, he's holding the accelerator in his hand, the circular accelerator in his hand. This is now this. This is 26.6 kilometer. This is the biggest machine on the surface of the earth that we have right now. Where the large Hadron Collider is. The circumference is 26.6 kilometer. And single beam is about 7 tera electron volts. So the combination is about 13 tera electron volts under mass energy. So it's a huge energy. Okay? But still people are not content with this one. People think, no, this is not enough. Now, the idea is to build another one which is 100 kilometer. Now, of course, this requires a lot of money. Lots of dollars, lots of euros, lots of pounds. Because rupees are no worth of it. It's so expensive business. And if you look at this figure here, going to 2020, we are down here. We are having this, this is an old V-graph, but you can see the sun was here, 3.5 tera electron volts over here. But you can see now the wavelength values, explore values is going down. So it means you can go down and down and down. Remember I said, if you increase the velocity, then you will be reducing the de Broglie wavelength. Okay? So you're reducing, by increasing velocity, with increasing energy, you're reducing the de Broglie wavelength, it means your evolution is going